Hi there. Today on Typical Books, I'm going to talk about the necrophiliac and a little true crime. The Necrophiliac is a 1972 novella. It's a very short novelette, perhaps, and a longish novella written by Gabrielle Wittkop in the French. This was translated in 2011 by Don Pabst, and this edition, I don't know if there's others, but this is the cutest edition available by ECW Press out of Toronto. True to the title, Le Necrophile, or The Necrophiliac, follows the journey of Lucien and a antiques dealer in Paris who actually is a necrophile and keeps a diary to that effect. It's really very dark. It's also extremely beautiful. I would call this like extreme, l'heure, extrêmement, but it isn't out there for the shock and the awe and the exploitative nature of extreme work. It's certainly not splatterpunk because it doesn't really bend you into the morals of this or have a social statement, really. It has a philosophical statement for sure, so it is transgressive literature in the height of the meaning of that word, in that it's transgressing a very taboo boundary that I believe transcends all culture. Alongside other huge taboos, let's say, we'll just pull one out of a hat, cannibalism, something that we have a lot of historical recounting of, and things that you can write about, that you can write in more extreme and very taboo ways, or you can do a philosophical deep dive into that sort of world. You've got your Jack Ketchum stories, or you've got your Thomas Harris stories. Very different, same taboo. Necrophilia, on the other hand, is something that we don't really dip into. Sure, there's extreme horror that deals with it, but it's something that seems so very far gone that we don't want to read about that necessarily. This, on the other hand, is written so beautifully, so introspectively, that it's very hard for me to not recommend it. I would highly recommend this, where it's hard in sort of dance around recommending books about cannibalism or other books about necrophilia to people. This I could pretty much recommend to anyone. It is very dark. It is very grotesque. It is extremely visceral. It's very realistic, although it is very clinical. And it is like Lolita, a look into a monstrous mind, handled in a way that is very straightforward. Lucien is who he is, much like Humbert. Humbert is who he was, and doesn't really, you know, candy coat it. And they're not on a soapbox to talk about the way that they are. It seems that with those busting boundaries, breaking social order, there's, you know, most types want to talk about it. You've got, let's say, Satanists. When you have Satanists on the news, they love talking about Satanism. I don't think any necrophile likes talking about this the way that Lucien does. And it seems he's keeping this diary as a constant companion, a conversation. It's not a diary in the way of documenting his days, particularly in other aspects other than necrophilia. It's his necrophilia journal. And it is very, very beautiful. Recently, there was caught in England a necrophilic serial murder. Now that they've changed the definition of serial murder to two victims, people who don't kill too many people are now serial killers. So a serial killer necrophile. He also kept a journal. David Fuller was known as the Bedsit Murderer, and the Bedsit murders were the murders of two women who were unsolved until late last year. Through DNA evidence, they identified his brother and then subsequently arrested David Fuller. Tunbridge Wells is where he's from and where the two murders were committed and his other crimes. And that is south east of London in the south of England, and likely a very beautiful place. A bedsit, from what I understand, is sort of like a granny suite or like a one bedroom student accommodation, so to speak. And one of them was murdered in her small apartment, a one bedroom sort of bachelorette place. And the other was abducted and taken elsewhere. Extremely gory, very visceral. And the police at the time thought that it was someone else who had a record of other brutal murders and sex attacks like this. They looked at other killers and they linked the two cases very quickly, but they had nothing really to go on, aside from lots of DNA evidence. But if you've never been fingerprinted, your fingerprints aren't on file. If you've never had a DNA sample given to the police, then it's pretty much useless, right? So this case was very cold. This is, what, 1987. So DNA has come a long way since then, and they found David Fuller. When they arrested David Fuller, the full extent of his crimes became quickly apparent. You can see a lot of video online about the arrest, his interrogations, his questioning. You can see body camera footage of them going into his home. This befuddled elder gentleman, because he's a lot older now than he was when he initially committed his crimes. I was first introduced to David Fuller through the Murder Was the Case podcast, where Dr. Lee Mellor talks quite extensively because he studied necrophilia. He wrote the book on it, quite literally. I've talked about his textbook before. He talked about this crime and how explosive it was, and it's not really getting the news over here considering how horrific it is. You say horrific, two murders, how does this link to the necrophile? Well, turns out Mr. Fuller was a necrophile. And in the words, paraphrasing Dr. Lee Mellor, this could very well be a case of him turning to a less incendiary or less risky behavior as far as his proclivities with sexual deviance and as abnormal sexual behavior. He began with corpses after these murders, and as far as I know, he hasn't killed anyone since, but he did turn to hundreds, if not thousands, of corpses, some violated more than once. He was an electrician in a mortuary, and that's how he gained access. And he had an all-access pass to this place for years, and they are finding many, many of the deceased that he had violated and contacting family members. And he spent time with them on repeat occasions. So it's just a very dark, very horrific thing. Now, how he reminds me so much of Lucien N is that he kept a diary. Not only did he keep a diary, he kept a video. And that is what the police found when they raided his home. And I use raided in the most gentle term. They knew they had their man for these murders. They searched his apartment looking for more evidence. Not that they necessarily needed it. They had plenty. They had the clincher with DNA. They had other reasons to support this claim. Yet, in any investigation, you search the person's house. And they found hard drives. And they found documents. They found all sorts of photographs and just reams of shit. Yeah, we're talking about necrophilia. I feel I can say shit. So, not unlike Lucien, he kept a diary, not as beautiful or poetic as this particular book by any means, but it is this horror come to life. I feel a little safer in recommending you read a book like The Necrophiliac by Gabrielle Wittkop, in that you can now go to YouTube or the evening news and read what it would be like to capture this particular person. And I think that that's helpful in many ways. I'm not the type that needs that sort of closure or always needs to have a real life stand-in, a scapegoat, a proxy, somebody to liken these fictional characters with. But it's very interesting and helpful, and we get to see what would play out if Lucien gets caught. Now Lucien, the person in the necrophiliac, does make some pretty quick getaways at times. He likes to raid graveyards. So he goes to funerals sometimes or just scours the obituaries, and he finds recently deceased that he can dig up. So he's very ghoulish in that way, the full sense of the word, a grave robber. And he will retrieve these corpses and spend time with them. There's no easing into it in this book. In page one, there is some very grotesque, visceral, and in-your-face sexual activity with a corpse. So it starts like that and does not let go. He has relationships with them. And it's very interesting to see that playing out of the mindset of somebody like Jeffrey Dahmer, who wanted this sort of thing, but in a living zombie type person. I would have liked to known if Jeff Dahmer had ever read this. I think that it would have been up his alley in the most wrong way, but it is very beautiful. I actually had to take a break halfway through reading this. Beauty aside, wonderful story, interesting character, interesting activities, beautifully written, very dark, and a real mind's eye into this man's life and what he has to go through to mask the scent, or the times that he doesn't care about masking the scent, the times that he revels in the scents of these corpses, the different levels of putrefaction that he has to deal with and how he deals with them. It's very detailed in very few words, very simple language, just very wonderfully written yet. And it's not that it was too gross for me or anything. It was just too deep and it was too real. So I had to take a little break in the middle. I also didn't want this little tiny book to pass by in an hour or two, because you could literally read this in an hour or two. But I wanted to savor that experience and let it kind of ramble around in my mind a little bit. And it's worth it to give serious thought to topics like these, I believe. It's, you know, not as fun of a romp as most extreme horror, where you just sort of gung-ho and read it as fast as you can because you're on that kind of wave. This is not a wave, it is an ocean, and you need to stand back, just sort of drink it all in. So I do highly recommend this journey into a very dark mind of Lucian and in the Necrophiliac, and highly recommend, especially if you enjoy closure after reading very, very dark literature like this, to check out the true crime case of David Fuller. The Bedsit Murderer has been caught. It's wonderful news, really, for the families. It's also the darkest news for the family when they find out what other crimes he was committing, and horribly heartbreaking news for the families of those he'd come in contact with after they were dead. Especially devastating to the families of Wendy Nell and Carolyn Pierce, the two women who lost their lives in 1987, and the killer was not caught until now. Very disturbing, more disturbing than the Necrophiliac. So it really depends on if you enjoy your true crime more than fiction, or fiction more than true crime, whichever one you can or can't handle as well. There's something, if you're interested in this sort of material, to read for both sides of that coin. So if you want to hear more about the Bedsit Murderer, definitely tune in to Murder Was the Case podcast. And Juan at Plagued by Visions has talked about the Necrophiliac as well. So definitely check out Juan's channel, because that is where I heard of this book and I had to read it toot sweet. So thank you very much for watching. Apologies for the very heavy subject matter. So if you have read the Necrophiliac or followed the Bedsit Murderer case, definitely let me know in the comments below. Thank you so much for watching, and have an ooky spooky day.